Hey guys, we are here at Thunderbird Studio with Michael Pope.
Yeah, how's it going?
You might know this guy from Bethel Music. This is also his studio. He runs this with a couple other guys, and we are here today to talk about his brand new pedal board.
So fancy.
There's a lot of colors, there's a lot of blinking lights, yeah. And there's a lot to talk about. So we're gonna kind of get into it. So why don't we dive in? Why don't we talk about the pedal board? Basically, to give you guys a quick overview of what's going on here and off camera, is right now it's set up as a wet-dry-wet rig. So we have one dry amp taking care of all the overdrives, and then we have two wet amps taking care of all the modulation, delay, reverb, all that type of stuff. So we're basically gonna talk and listen quickly to the dry section, take a quick break, and then we're gonna come back into the modulation, the left, right, those wet amps, and then we'll talk about those in a bit of depth and detail as well.
Yeah, so, sounds good.
First things first, I have to say, with this pedal board, this is probably the nerdier side of me coming out. My favorite thing about this pedal board is not actually the pedals, it's the control that Michael has over the pedals. I think it's incredible. I mean, you have RJM PBC, which can do everything you can think of
and much more. It's a spaceship in and of itself, man.
Like
it's probably the most usable piece of gear I've ever found for anything. Just creating presets, it's so useful live or in the studio, and just being able to toggle so quickly between a preset mode and an instant access mode. And then, I mean, the million things it does with MIDI and sending tap tempo to, you know, even via TRS to some other pedals, like it's super powerful.
Yeah. So even with all its complexity, it's still, once you get the basics down, quite simple to use. So why don't we dive in? Let's go through kind of the beginning of your signal chain.
All right.
And we'll just stop after we finish up with your dry amp.
Cool.
But yeah, what's first?
Well, first is the input hidden in your nifty little bank switch.
Yep.
It's just a simple guitar input. It's got a little output for the tuner. I've been on too many dark stages where I need to play slide and can't see a thing, so the always-on tuner thing is just like a nice safeguard.
Yep.
But other than that, it's just a clean spot for the cable to go in, and then it sends through the rest of the board. The first real pedal that it hits is the compressor all the way over there, because that's the only place we can fit it.
It's a tight board.
It's, you know, there's not much room left, which I really like. I think if I went any bigger than this, my back would probably just give out and I'd be done for good. So, yeah. So the compressor is the only thing that's like, you know, always on as well. Everything else kind of comes and goes. So it kind of made sense to just keep it there out of the way. It's really barely doing anything, just kind of like evening out the amps a little bit.
Yeah.
I like amps that kind of air on the stiff side and kind of just give you like this strong, punchy sound. So the compressor helps just, you know, retain that, but kind of smooth it out and sound a little bit prettier.
Yeah.
So I'm not really doing much with that.
And you really would have quite the time turning that thing off.
Yeah, I mean, fitting my foot like sideways while I'm trying to play a part would be somewhat difficult, so that, you know, it stays on because it's easy.
So then after that, am I right that it's POG next?
Yeah, into the switcher, and then everything's obviously in the loop. So yeah, just the POG next.
All right. What is that? Let's hear just what your clean sound is, just your compressor,
cool,
couple chords, and then we'll go into briefly in the POG as well.
Cool. So clean tone. Amp's just kind of like barely on the edge of breakup. If I dig in, breaks up just a little bit, but fundamentally clean.
It sounds okay.
It's fine, you know.
Yeah.
Gets the clean job done.
Yeah. Clean is covered, well and truly. Okay. Oh, that sounds awesome.
Yep.
And then we head into POG. Really quickly, what do you normally use a POG for?
I mean, a million different things, really. The POG 2 is such an interesting not departure, but interesting version of the POG, just with the extra octaves, with the filter. So most of the time, I'm using it to make a line sound a little bit bigger. Yeah. So it's not like a crazy organ thing. Maybe a little bit of a 12 string, yeah. Not, you know, not quite as, you know, out of tune. But just kind of lifts parts. It's just such a useful tool for so many different things. The presets in it are nice. Maybe one of these days I'll get it, you know, MIDI modded and kind of complete everything with this. But
hide it away entirely.
Exactly.
And just presets on the,
exactly.
on the RJM.
Yeah.
Cool.
So yeah, I mean, it just adds more octaves.
So safe to say you use it more to just stick out in the mix a little bit, play a part, and then come back
exactly.
and turn it off, and you can go to the next part of the song.
Exactly. It's just when you need that, like, one more, you know, more louder.
Yep.
When
you I usually need a few one mores.
Yeah. Yeah. When you need that, the POG is there, man.
Okay.
It's there for you.
No, I love it. That's cool. And then after that, this is one of my favorite pedals on the board again. I mean, I love the control factor, but if I had to pick a favorite, this thing's out of control.
It's pretty nuts, man.
So this is the fuzz.
Yeah.
Tell us about it. Tell us how you have it wired up, what you love about it.
Yeah. Well, one, I like that I just want a fuzz that sounds as big as possible. So, I mean, it's pretty good.
I love it. So this is the Evil Filter, Death by Audio Effects. They're
so cool, man.
Big
they're like
sound,
some of the coolest
pedal.
Pedals.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, the big box is cool too. Real estate, who cares? If it looks good, if it's a big box, it sounds good. The big box adds to the sound, right?
Yeah, of course.
So it's just a big, big sounding fuzz. And then with the filter, I can kind of, you know, control it. So I think it's on like a weird low pass thing now, so. Very much like a synth. However, I could like band pass it and kind of maybe do more of the like wah thing. So yeah, there's just a lot of different things that pedal will do. You know.
It sounds like we're about ready to start a dubstep cover band.
I mean, we might be, man.
Just
Skrillex, look out.
Putting the option out there. And then there's a volume in the effects loop of the pedal.
Yes, that's very important. Good to mention. That is to control the input level going into the pedal. If you essentially turn it all the way up, it's basically like, you know, it's not there. And the fuzz just kind of implodes on itself and actually sounds a little bit smaller. Sounds crazy, but it's a little too like gargly and
a bit gated.
Kind of implodes on itself.
Yeah.
So I was like, man, that's a bummer. I really want to use this pedal. And the only way I could get it to like do the big thing that I was looking for was like rolling my guitar volume down.
Yeah.
But then all of a sudden that sucks every time I want to make a fuzz preset, like I've got to kill the volume. So that's no fun. So we made this little volume box. It's just like a volume knob on your guitar.
Yeah.
It just has a fancy knob on it. And you can now, so I'll turn it all the way off, you can now control the input level going into the fuzz, which just makes it super usable.
I just smile every time I hear that pedal, man.
It's
just
cool, yeah. And I mean, you can go in between.
I think it's safe to say the POG isn't even turned on at this point.
No,
this
no,
is
no.
Just
it's
the fuzz and the compressor.
I mean,
which
you could turn
on
both on. But I mean, I don't know how useful the POG is at that point.
That is, there's just so much bottom end in there, so much texture. That's
a lot,
incredible.
Man. It's a lot, so.
Oh, man. All right, well, we have to keep moving. Unfortunately, we have to keep going. I could stop there and stay there all day.
We'll do a separate video just on the
bus. After that, you have the Super Bowl.
Yeah.
Right up here.
Yep, just normal overdrive. I, yeah, That's really all you can say to sum that pedal up.
Is there anything, like when you turn that on, is there any sound in your head you're kind of after, going for, envisioning?
Yeah, the way I kind of do drives is I have one that's a little more gainy, which is the Benson, which we'll get to. And then the Super Bowl is just kind of made to sound like the amps are turned up a little bit more. So, yeah. You know. You know, not getting too much dirtier, but just adding a little bit of that, like, you know, tube amp compression kind of a thing.
Pushing the amps a bit.
Half clean, half dirty tone. Yeah, and that's all that does. A little bit more.
So that's a little bit more of a tame overdrive, push the amps a little bit, tiny bit more gain, a little bit of breakup.
Right.
Moving on to the Benson. This is something I've been so excited to hear, man, as soon as it was announced.
I was so excited when he came out with this pedal. I had a small part to play in the creation of the Chimera amp, and I've got the first one ever sitting back here. Super proud of it.
Yeah.
I love that amp, and I love everything that Chris makes. He just... The sound that's in my head, that guy knows how to build it somehow. So that pedal is the exact preamp from my favorite amp.
Yeah.
However, it's using FETs instead of tubes, and I just love the way it sounds. So it's a little more the gainier sound, I guess clean. It's just like perfect. It sounds like a cranked amp. It sounds like the cranked amp that I love.
Yep.
And I mean, it works well with so many things, man. Like, we've used it direct in on bass, we've used it on a bunch of other things, and it's just like, it always just sounds cool and kind of has its own character. So I'm super sold on that thing. I love
it. If I had that on my board, would I be able to do those lines? I'm sold.
There we go.
I'm sold. I'm done.
Yeah.
I'm getting a Benson.
That lick is built into that pedal.
Brilliant.
So,
good to know. All right. That's cool. That sounds amazing. So a bit more gain, obviously, than the Super Bowl, but you wouldn't stack them. You'd use them separately for different reasons, different contexts. So where, in what context would you use the Benson for? Anything in particular?
It kind of just depends, man. Both of them, one of the things I like about both pedals is they're pretty touch sensitive. So if I, you know, the more I dig in, the more I get out of it. And same thing with the Benson, you know.
There's that built-in riff.
That's the only thing
every
you
time.
Can play through that pedal.
No, I love it.
I don't know how you play other things through it. a lot of it for me is just like, what tone do I want? Do I want something that's a little more mid-rangey, or do I want something that's a little more open? You know, if I need something more mid-rangey, it's gonna be the Benson or whatever is in that spot, you know? One thing I have carried over from this, you know, from other rigs, is I kind of do like a more open sounding drive and then a more mid-rangey sounding thing. So it kind of just depends on the pedal, and I try to let my right hand dictate how much drive it's putting out. Obviously sometimes you need to change that by adding a boost or by stacking, but this kind of just works for me.
Very cool. So moving on, I have a true or false for you.
Okay.
True or false, every guitar player needs the option for a DS1 on their
True.
Okay.
True. I would say true. Yeah.
I mean, there's a lot of questions that these guys are thinking of. I'm confident that that is one of them.
Ask away, guys.
As you guys can see, subtle hint, there is a DS1 off the side of the pedal board.
Yeah.
This is from the 80s, you were saying.
It's from 1982, so I'm not going to say that makes it sound better or worse than a brand new one. I don't have a brand new one to compare it to.
Yep.
I'll admit, I bought it because it's a DS1, and everybody is like, oh, it sounds awful. And there is a very real thing. Sometimes what sounds awful is what sounds right in a track. So I bought it. I think Boss pedals are cool. They're super iconic. I just bought it, and honestly, I think it sounds really cool. So it's in the audition loop, I guess. Today for this video, we were, you know, working on a track that needed that pedal, so.
And it's orange.
It's orange. You know?
I mean, there's
a little late for Halloween, but there it is.
It's orange. Yeah, no, this is good. So as you were saying, I mean, right between the Benson and then what we're going to talk about next, the Aqueduct, there is Audition.
Yeah.
And so that's one of the pedals, super straightforward, simple pedal that we make.
Yeah.
But it allows you to slot in pedals that maybe you don't want to commit to every single time you play.
Right.
But you might need it in a studio session, or maybe this might be a 808 next time in the next session.
Or maybe, you know, some fancy new overdrive comes out and you want to try it without ripping up your fancy Goodwood board. So,
So we have it powered, and then the DS1 is right after the Benson. So should we take a listen?
Yeah.
I don't know what the settings are. If this is.
I don't know either. Yeah,
beautiful.
It sounds cool, man. I don't know why people hate on it. I mean, I guess you could make it sound bad. And yeah, it's a little hairy, but...
That's awesome.
I think it sounds
cool. It has its place.
Yeah.
Great. Yeah. All right, so we'll turn it off because it's not actually in a loop. So we'll turn it off at the pedal.
Yep.
And then after that, we go to the Earthquaker Devices Aqueduct.
Yes, sir.
This is... It's a unique pedal.
Yeah.
It does some awesome, crazy sounds, but also
sure does.
Some more usable ones as well on the day-to-day.
Yeah, I'm a big fan of vibrato. It's such a cool effect, and it's such a usable effect. Like it's kind of like, when you use it subtly, it's kind of like instant vibe on a track. So just started kind of playing around with a bunch of different vibratos. There's so many good ones out there. The Walrus Julia, I love that. That almost made it on this board. The random setting on this pedal sounds so much like tape emulation.
Yeah.
Just like old tape machine, kind of get that like random, you know, warble out of it. And it does get weird pretty fast. If I'm honest, like that's why I've never really used Earthquaker stuff before, is I think a lot of their stuff gets kind of weird, at least for my application. But this was just too good to pass up. So
cool.
Yeah, it gets weird, but it also is just like... like subtle and vibey, you know? It's like so good, I think about the pedal and don't concentrate on playing. And I play dumb things. It's just a great little vibe, you know? Like throw a little bit of reverb on it or something. And I know I'm jumping ahead, but yeah, it's just... instant vibe.
So you'd use it for some movements.
Yeah, just to...
a little bit of pitch.
Yeah, if I'm, you know, playing something maybe a little more delicate, and I don't want to have, like, that big, like, 80s vibrato or something on it. And, yeah, it's cool. But, I mean, you could also do something really, you know, out there. And if you... it's there for you.
Awesome. It does it all.
Exactly.
All right, and then after that we have the Trem, which is one of the other pedals controlled by the Expressionator.
Yes.
Greatest effect of all time! That was Mikey.
Arguably.
He has, let's say, strong opinions about tremolo. Subtle, but strong.
I don't disagree. It's a pretty great effect.
You finally found someone that agrees with you.
I don't disagree. I might disagree at a later date. I might disagree when that fuzz pedal's on.
Yeah.
But for now, we'll say that is the best effect of all time.
So what would you use it? How would you use it in a live or a studio setting? What's something you'd go to for?
Again, just kind of like a vibe thing. Like sometimes you just need trem.
Say no more.
It's self-explanatory, you know? It just sounds great. So the Expression, it'll do the helicopter. So, you know, maybe kind of ring mod. So there's that. I'll probably use that less. And the cool thing about this one, besides the fact that it does harmonic tremolo, which is also very cool, it also will take tap tempo from the PBC.
Yep.
So I'm using the auto tap feature to send clock to this pedal. So it's, you know, pull up a preset, it's in time with everything else, and sounding right. And then I can also control the rate with that if
you
I want to
override
the exactly
PVC. Yeah.
Exactly. I can override that to do the helicopter thing, change presets, and it's back in time. Yeah. So yeah, it's awesome. Kind of a little toy.
So we're almost at the end of the dry chain, what the dry amp is seeing. Right. After this, we have a volume pedal, pretty self-explanatory. You can turn your volume off, you can turn your volume on, you can do swells.
On, off. On, off. You know.
Right.
And I think it's worth saying too, like, I love the way I'm doing volume on this board. I think the Vertex Boost is like, it's kind of like the PVC and the fact that it's like just such a useful pedal. Like, if it was only a boost, it would sound really, really great. But controlling volume via expression off that pedal is, for me, just been so much more reliable, man. I've had every volume pedal, you know, made, and I've broken pretty much all of them. And this is just super reliable. If the pedal does physically break, I'm not losing tone during a show or a performance. Like, I can pop the cable up very quickly, finish the show, and anywhere in the world, you know, get any volume pedal, get any expression pedal, and I'm back in business, you know? So that's great. And then also having a boost outside of the loop kind of, I found, has saved me a preset on here. Like, a lot of presets, maybe from like a verse to a chorus, would just be an extra gain stage from the boost. So having it outside, I can kind of just click that on and off, and it doesn't interfere with preset land.
And good to know, this might be obvious to some of you guys, but the boost is after all the gain stages.
Right.
And so you take the gain that's been decided by maybe the Super Bolt or the Benson, and then you're lifting that gain stage just a little bit more with the Vertex Boost as well.
Exactly.
Just to poke through the mix, just that extra little bit.
You get a little bit more volume depending on where you have the amps, but I'm a fan of pushing the amps harder as opposed to pushing a pedal and saturating more. So, yeah.
Awesome.
That's doing that.
So that's your dry amp. I mean, thank you so much.
Man.
We'll be back in 2 seconds, just like that.
Internet magic.
For the wet amps. See you guys. All right, guys. Hey, Mikey here from Goodwood Audio.
We're back.
We are.
Here we are.
Yeah, you said internet magic.
Now.
Here I am.
Yep.
I'm the only one not wearing a black top.
I tried to, you know, help you out with the flannel.
Yeah, you did say that Reading is the uniform here is black, black, and black.
Yep.
Yeah.
Wow. Pretty much.
Sorry for bucking that trend.
Yeah, it's cool, man.
What we heard initially was a bunch of what we would call dry effects, overdrive, boost. We also have the aqueduct and the tremolo. I don't know that you would consider them to be dry effects. It just happens to be where we are in the signal chain.
Yeah.
So that was through your Vox.
Yep. The Vox is acting as the dry amp.
Yeah.
And then the two Bensons are handling all the
stuff. Cool. So let's get into that stuff.
Cool.
First cab off the rank is the stereo chorus.
Yes, sir.
I mean, just tell me and them about it. Yeah.
I mean,
and play some Andy Summers stuff, please.
Sure. Chorus is one of those things, like, everybody kind of hated it until everybody was obsessed with it.
Funny how it works, right?
I don't know, man.
Yeah.
It's weird. Modulation was uncool like 10 years ago, and now it's like the coolest thing. So, yeah, I honestly just kind of found myself like needing a chorus. I think I was doing a session with Gabe Wilson, and he was like, man, we need chorus on this or something. So we used something he had, and then I was like, well, I should probably find a chorus. He's, you know, asking me to use it. And this is just what I found I love. A modded one by Vertex. He doesn't make them anymore, I don't think.
Okay. The original unit isn't.
It's an old like Arion stereo chorus. I guess they were big in like the 90s.
SCH-Z.
Dash Z or Z.
Z is where I'm from.
Z is cooler. I just sound like a dummy if I say Z. So.
And I sound dummy if I say Z. Z.
There we go. Stalemate. But. It's just a great sounding pedal. It's really wide. It kind of does this weird like it almost throws you off when you hear it on its own, because it just like completely just like, I can't work the guitar anymore.
What's going on, man? Am I making you nervous?
Just a little bit. I keep thinking you're gonna turn the tremolo on when I'm not looking.
I have many leather-bound books.
Okay.
And my apartment smells of rich mahogany.
Can't wait to go to your house.
It's a long flight, let me tell you. Okay.
I just did that flight, yeah, so no, you trust did. Me, I can handle yeah. it. Chorus pedals, yay. It's stereo. It flips your phase and... Up,
so. Yeah, it's okay. Can you, you know. Very, very quickly in a sentence or two explain what you mean by it flip your phase?
Yeah, basically it makes the waveforms do weird things and kind okay. of like just sounds off. Phase is a tricky thing to explain. You guys yeah. could probably do it a lot more eloquently.
Can I try?
Yeah, do it.
So when one speaker is, phase issues happen when you've got two sound sources, two amps, which we have. So when one speaker is pushing that way, another speaker is actually pushing that way. And what happens is the sine waves kind of cancel each other out.
Yep.
And you get this weird filtering effect where certain frequencies are
yeah.
Sort of nullified or canceled.
Exactly. One of the problems with running stereo, but
sure.
when you get it right, it's very good.
Right, and that's where some of the Goodwood Audio devices, I'm looking at my business partner here, help that with the transformer versions. You know, you've got a phase issue, right. press that black button and you're good to go.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You can kind of hear it. It's like when you switch.
That wasn't natural at all. Weird product placement. Sorry.
I love it. When you, like, you can kind of hear it when you just like let something ring and turn it on. Like it just mm-hmm. kind of messes with your ears a little bit. Mm-hmm. Hopefully you're wearing headphones.
Totally. Or have good. Yeah. You're going to hear it more on the low end because it's a bigger sine wave that can cancel itself out.
Right.
And so it's really bad. Any bass players that for some reason are watching this, it's crucial, right?
Right.
Yeah. It's crucial that you fix phase issues on the bass.
Yeah. So yeah, that's my not phaser pedal, but phase pedal.
Totally.
It's chorus.
That's cool, man.
It's lovely.
Awesome.
You want to sound like the 80s. Yeah.
I love it. So we've got two specular tempers on the board.
Correct.
And one's handling delay.
Yep.
And one's handling... So these are kind of the Strymon replacements?
They replaced the Strymon
okay.
Stuff ever so slightly for various reasons.
Oh, yeah.
Again, going back to the inspiration thing, I dove into them with the editor and all the different things you can do with them, and I love the way they sound, and I love the flexibility, particularly in a studio, that it gives me. I mean, I can change the panning of things on a per uh-huh. preset level. So uh-huh. I could, with a stereo rig, I could have a wet amp and a dry amp
right.
on one preset, and then switch to like a full stereo
right.
verb, or right. like reverb in one, delay in the other. Not that I would necessarily need to do that all the time, but if I wanted to make, you know, a specific part really interesting, I could do that. It's just kind of a cool, useful thing. And on top of that, they just sound really, really great. And two of them, because they do both reverb and delay, but for the way I run things, it kind of makes more sense for me to dedicate one to delay and one to reverbs. And the reverberant one is just kind of handling more normal reverbs. So like plates, springs, don't use hall a ton. It's mostly plate and spring, but
normal stuff. Can you talk about, I mean, we'll hit a couple of sound examples, but I think you mentioned earlier, none of this kind of covers up bad playing. But actually, in my experience, when you turn the gain up, it's good at covering bad playing, but even more so, delay and reverb are a great way of kind of masking. I want to say sloppy playing, but I think
it,
so.
It can.
So someone that's, you know, at your level, when you're looking at delay and reverb, and these days reverb is so trendy. Talking to some other guys that are in a similar position to you, like tour a lot, record a lot, play live a lot on records that we all listen to, specifically with delay, and then we can get to the reverb.
Yeah.
What are you trying to, you know, what are you trying to dial in? What are you listening for?
Balance.
Okay.
Zen. Yeah. I love like every church guitar player should. I'm a big fan of the Edge.
Right.
And just the way he perfectly uses those effects. Like, there's not too much, but there's not too little.
Yeah.
And it's really easy to kind of live in either one of those camps. So with delay, I'm kind of, if I'm using a delay, it's very rarely to fill space.
Okay.
I try to do more like reverbs for that kind of a thing. Delay is kind of to be, it's a part of the part, if that makes sense. There's some parts, you know, that I've written or that I continue to write where it's maybe doesn't seem like a part of the part.
Okay.
But that's kind of my approach to it. It's, you know, it's very basic. It's almost always like just a very simple tape sound.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll kind of flip between different, you know, subdivisions to see what fits best with what I'm playing. But the question in my head is always, is this working with the part? Is this, you know, making the part sound like the part?
Okay.
You know, is it doing what it's supposed to be doing in that context? So maybe a little bit general, but...
That's cool, man. I mean...
It's kind of a simple thing for me, and yeah, delay is delay. It just adds that extra, like, rhythmic element to...
So whatever the...
Otherwise maybe boring.
Delay part. Sound you're going for, mix is important.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it just completely depends on the part. Most of the time, I'd say if delay's on, I like to hear that it's on.
Mm-hmm.
So you can hear a delay on my playing. You know, I'm not the guy that's got, you know, you hear some line and then stop playing and then you hear like the delay trail in the back. It's like you kind of hear the delay
mm-hmm.
all the time.
Mm-hmm.
That's, again, going back to the Edge. That's just,
cool,
just the sound that I love when it comes to delay. But yeah, it's is this filling out the part correctly but not overtaking my playing? And if the answer is yes, then we're good to go.
Can we hear an example of that?
Yeah. So this tone, haven't dialed these in
sure.
a bunch
That's
yet,
good.
Right?
Yeah.
New board, but so that would be something that I would probably typically use, you know, maybe for more like rakes. Filling out space,
totally.
Nice trail.
I mean, the delay is...
It's such a specific thing.
Right.
Without diving into it and going through all the presets, yeah. which I just haven't had time to do yet.
Yeah, no, it's all good. I mean, the delay is really present and it does ring out, but your core tone is still front and center.
Yeah.
It's the first thing we hear.
Yeah.
That's awesome. And then, I mean, you've talked a lot about it. So
mm-hmm.
the next... on the board is the verb, same yep. pedal.
Yeah. It's just handling, you know, very basic reverb. So like this is just a normal sounding plate. You know, maybe a little bit heavy for more of an ambient thing. I love the band Beach House.
Beautiful.
I don't know if you guys listen to Beach House, but try to make reverb sound like you know, Beach House songs essentially. So yeah, that's very normal.
Nice,
but
man.
Again, you know, mix and decay time and all that completely dependent on the song. And the later date that'll all be programmed into
for sure.
to this guy and
yeah.
you know, be pulling up the sounds that I need. But yeah, again, it's the same thing. Reverb's maybe more of a texture for me, whereas delay is the part. Reverb is kind of how I like to fill space or make the guitar sound bigger than it should be
mm-hmm.
or maybe fit into a very specific spot.
Let's hit the Mercury 7. There's a couple of other pedals that I've skipped over that I need to get back to. So
yeah.
let's go Mercury 7. I know you Grant talked
also,
about it on the expression, and it's a mix control. So
yeah,
so no reverb, 100% wet.
All right. Less crazy reverb, a lot more crazy reverb. So whereas the Specular Tempest number 2 is handling more of the like normal stuff, the Mercury 7 for me is kind of doing more of the like ethereal, crazy, big stuff. So like, need to dial it in more, but plan mm-hmm. is, you know, heel down. It's a big verb, but you know.
Yeah, I mean that's, but again, the guitar is not pushed way back. It's
exactly.
still right there.
Exactly. But if I go up here, The guitar is pushed back a little more. Lately, but
I should point out as well that we're hearing all three amps right now. So we're hearing Benson left and right, and we're also hearing the AC30 in the middle. Yeah. So there is always, no matter what, in this control room, there is always a dry amp.
Yeah.
If we hit this mute button like that, now this is just wet only. So if we pull back, so there's a little bit of reverb, still super present. But even with this toe down, I mean, it's still there. I mean,
yeah. And honestly, for this pedal, I'll probably have it overtake the guitar a little bit more. There are totally situations where you want those kind of effects to just like go nuts and haywire and completely overtake the guitar. You know, there's a use for all of it.
Totally.
But yeah, that pedal's handling more the ethereal stuff, and I can have just kind of like a bed to lay on with it being back, or just have it completely swallow the guitar. Cool.
So
the ones we forgot.
Yeah, the two things we forgot.
Too excited.
You and Grant talked about the volume is actually the vertex boost, and you're controlling it by expression.
Yes, sir.
But what we need to talk about is that there's actually an option for a level control, and then the volume goes from no volume to where the boost is set.
Yeah, so I mean, basically it's acting like a normal volume pedal with a boost after it would. So the boost is just hitting the amps harder, so I'm getting a volume jump, and I'm also getting a little more gain. So I'd use that just like anybody would use a boost pedal.
Right.
And then the volume is always controlling volume.
Got just really quickly, is a difference between boosting before and after?
There definitely is.
The way we generally explain it is boosting before your overdrives adds more gain.
Yep.
I don't really know how to explain that other than there is more signal pushing into and kind of creating more gain through clipping.
Yeah.
Boosting after your overdrives lifts whatever is happening in the overdrive section up.
Yeah.
In terms of volume.
Yeah.
And that's what you're after.
Yep.
So you are setting, you're happy with the gain that you're getting from the Benson, the Superbolt, and the compression, of course, and you want to just lift that.
I want there to be a little bit more gain, because I set the amps kind of on the edge of breakup.
Right.
They're not really going to get that much louder.
Right.
They're going to break up just a little bit more.
Right.
So I'm kind of, it's kind of a both and situation. It's a little bit of a volume boost and a little bit of a gain boost. I like that sound. Pushing a pedal harder often, again, clips harder.
Yeah.
Sounds a little more compressed, which equals small tone.
Got it.
So I want big guitar tone.
Because there's a difference between pushing a pedal and pushing an amp.
Yeah.
Right.
Valves just sound better pushed than pedals and transistors and FETs and...
Yeah. Op amps.
Nerdy. Op amps. Yeah. Nerdy circuit things, you know?
The last pedal, didn't mean to finish with this, but Philippe's a good dude we've never met,
what
but I'd love
to.
Yeah. I mean, Caroline Guitar Company. I was going to say FX. Caroline Guitar Company, the Kilobyte.
They're a company. Incorporated.
They are a company. So I understand that it is not actually in a loop, and there's a specific reason for that.
Kind of. Mostly because I didn't want to put two pedals in one loop.
Okay.
But I mostly use it as a slapback. Slapback is just like a really useful thing. A solo, a single note line. Anytime you're getting down on some Americana.
Can you describe...
It's just a good
slapback.
Sound.
Can you show us what you mean by slapback?
I mean, it's just a really fast...
It's literally...
Repeat. So like...
Bang, bang.
No delay. Just...
Can you hear that?
Right? And then... So just like a really fast repeat.
So it almost doubles the guitar.
Almost. like a little bit of vibe. And then this one's cool, one, because Dave Cobb uses it, so use everything he uses. That makes a noise.
The Havoc switch.
Does that.
I mean,
to take it back to the fuzz. Yeah. So yeah, it's
everything
great.
Comes back to fuzz.
Kind of a, I mean, one could argue that fuzz is actually the original. Well, you couldn't argue it because it's a fact. It's the original overdrive, distortion, all of the above. Everything came from the fuzz.
Speaking of fuzz, when I was young, you mentioned Stewie earlier, mm-hmm. and I heard the Glow record for the first time.
Yeah.
And I went to a music store and I said, because he uses a fuzz probe on Investigate in the instrumental part after Investigate. He uses it in the solo of Hang On To You.
Yep.
That crazy kind of sweeping whatever. I remember going to a music store and saying, do you have a pedal that makes me sound like a buzz? Like I'm buzzing?
Yeah.
They had no idea what I'm talking about.
Yeah. It was fuzz.
It was fuzz. Do you have any embarrassing...
The most embarrassing thing I did recently, two things. One was messing up that Andy Summers riff, simply because there's a camera in the room. That's the most embarrassing thing that I've done lately.
It's immortalized forever.
Second, I recently played at the Devil Awards with Corey Asbury.
Uh-huh.
And
wait, the gold boots moment?
Yes. We won't get into that. That's too involved for a pedal board video. And people can keep their opinions to themselves on those things.
Good.
I like them and they make me happy. End all be all. Basically what happened was the lovely people at TSA thought it'd be really great to like unscrew the IEC jack on my power supply.
Right.
So the stagehand plugged my board in, severed the connection.
Good.
No power. So for sound check, I had to basically just plug this guitar into a Boss tuner. Into a particularly not great backline amp.
Mm-hmm.
And I haven't used like a TU3 ever.
Uh-huh.
And I had no idea that the tiny little microscopic dot like under into the side of the note letter indicated sharp or flat.
Okay.
So dummy over here couldn't tune his guitar.
Dummy.
And was the guy that showed up to the Dove Awards with, you know, the broken pedal board and was too dumb to tune his guitar.
Dang.
So, true story.
Dang.
That one hurt.
You actually mentioned, right at the beginning, you kind of glossed over it. Mm-hmm. You talked about the Always On tuner.
Yeah.
And, I mean, we've done a lot of the boxes where you've got a separate out for the tuner.
Yeah.
And I always thought it was just because it's quick and easy to hit the volume and you can tune.
It's 100% because I won't name names, but... worked with an LD for lighting director, lighting dude, as I call him.
Yeah.
Or dudette. For some time. It could be a dudette. This one was a dude.
Okay.
But, you know, maybe there's some ladies out there with some really good LD skills. I'm sure there are. Worked with one particular, and in the song Forever, like I'm playing slide and in the chorus, like doubling the vocal. And at the end of the bridge, like we do this like walk up thing, and I drop the slide down, like really exaggerated, crazy sound, and come right back in, doubling the vocal. And our LD thought like right when we drop that slide, it'd be cool to just like completely black out the stage.
Perfect timing.
And awesome. After like two tours of like screaming over the MD mic, turn those lights, but like, what are you doing? It was just kind of like, man, I'm really glad like that's always on, because I could just kind of like mute my guitar with the volume pedal, find the note, and come back in.
Got it.
Just so it's
little
it's,
hack.
It's a comfort issue
little
more
pedal
than
board
it
hack.
Is. Yeah,
yeah.
Anything.
Awesome.
Plus, I mean, if you're like, you know, bending a little note in the studio and you want to make sure you like end
bending in tune.
Yeah, if you're not super skilled at bends.
Even the pros cheat. So, hey man, this has been great.
It's been super fun.
Yeah, I hope you've had a good time.
This is my favorite.
We've all had a good time.
Thing, guitar thing I've ever filmed. I normally hate filming these things.
Oh man, so do I.
I'm serious.
take us out with. Look, I'm going to turn that on.
God.
And.